Hey Anthony, how's it going? We're live.
Right, yeah, it's not too bad, not too bad. We managed to make it work in the end, which is fortunate.
Yes. Unfortunately, my co-host couldn't be here, so I'm not gonna have a wild and crazy intro. So I think we're just gonna get right into the questions.
Okay.
So, my first question is to you: what initially brought you on the path of research, the subject of diamond? What brought you on the path research, you know, all this kind of different, you know, quote-unquote weird subject matter that seems to capture the attention of a lot of people. So I was just really curious on how that worked for you.
Yeah, well, I've been interested in alternate philosophies and the occult and various other things for, well, ever since probably I was about 10 or 11 years of age. So you're talking about nearly 50 years ago now. And there was a part magazine that came out in the UK in the late 1960s called Men, Myth and Magic, which very much intrigued me because it took me into the further areas of interest in the occult. So in other words, whereas most of my friends were actually doing some fairly basic stuff, I was really interested in the religious aspects of it, the psychological aspects of it, and the sociological aspects of it as well. So when I had the opportunity to go to university, I decided that I would study sociology and specifically focus in on the sociology of religion, the sociology of belief, and the social psychology of belief as well. So I carried that through for a few years, and at the same time, I continued my interest in UFOs and my interest in ghosts and hauntings and phenomena such as that. But then after I graduated and after I'd done my postgrad work, I was in the position where I moved into business, as most people did in those days, because you had to earn a living, you know, and the other routes, the academic routes and everything else were not going to be paying enough money or anything else in those days. So for probably 25, 30 years, I just worked as a business consultant, a management consultant. And I always had this burning urge to write a book, and I'd continued my interest in esoteric subjects right through that time. So in other words, after I left university, I continued reading. In other words, my reading never stopped, and my reading never stopped of the subjects I was interested in. So again, I was reading books on quantum physics, neurology, various other areas. And around about 2000, I was in the fortunate position that I was financially comfortable enough to do what I'd always planned to do, which was take a year out and write a book. Now, at that stage, I really didn't know what I was going to be writing about. It was just a something that I wanted to do. It was quite a powerful urge to do. So when I started taking the year out, it was in March 2000, I think it was, when I started the work, I literally started with a blank sheet of paper on a Word document. And I was sitting in front of the laptop, the computer, the desktop. And I suddenly started to feel as if I had a migraine headache coming on. Now, I suffer from classical migraine, which is that you will get an aura, you'll get the sensations, you'll get deja vu sensations, you get various other sensations, but you don't necessarily get the headache. In other words, it doesn't develop into a headache. It just puts you in a kind of weird altered state of consciousness. And one of the precursors, the prodromes for a migraine attack, is severe deja vu sensations. And as I was sitting in front of the computer screen, I had this profound deja vu sensation that I'd sat in front of that screen before, thinking the same thoughts in the same way. So when the aura ended, I decided I knew what I wanted to write about. It was as if the aura itself had given me the guidelines as to what I wanted to do. And it was to write a book about the deja vu phenomenon. And I started reading up on the subject, and I was surprised to discover that there'd been very little work done on exactly what we mean when we say that we have a sensation that we have either lived something before or where we are perceiving something for the second time. And I started to read up what I could on the subject, both on the internet and in various psychological documents, magazines, books, and everything else. And I came across the work of a guy called Dr. Arthur Funkhauser, who is an American, effectively an American physicist. His PhD is in physics. In fact, he specialized, because he's now a friend of mine, and I now know that he specialized in holograms and the and developing of holograms and lasers. And Art's hypothesis is an intriguing one, because Art suggested, or still suggests, that a deja vu sensation is that you have had, in recent history, you have had a dream. And that dream is precognitive. So effectively, you've had dreamt something, but you've effectively forgotten it. And you only start to recognize the fact that you have had the dream when you start to live it in three-dimensional reality. So there's suddenly this recognition. But the recognition is not from some time in your past. It's a recognition from a dream you have had in which you have lived that moment before. Now, I had the opportunity to discuss this with Art Funkhauser, and I said to Art, the one problem with this is that it implies something that is unscientific, in raised commas, which is that we are precognitive. In other words, if you have a precognitive dream, the implication is that the future is available in the past, or the future is available in the present time. Now, that is just as odd and weird as any other explanation of deja vu. And in fact, it's it suggests another reality of the way the mind works. So I started to look into the subject on a slightly different angle, and I started to look into the neurological aspects, and I was surprised to discover that when people have deja vu sensations, either people who have migraine or particularly individuals who suffer something called temporal lobe epilepsy, their deja vu sensations are part, again, of the pre-seizure aura that somebody will have that has temporal lobe epilepsy. And the neurological constructs, the neurological, neurochemicals, the neurotransmitters that bring about migraine and bring about affect the brain at the point of death and temporal lobe epilepsy are all similar. They're all a similar group of neurotransmitters, and one particular one, glutamate. And glutamate is also known to be responsible for the near-death experience. Now, what intrigued me here was that one of the elements of the near-death experience that's regularly recorded is in fact one of the moody traits, which is one of the list of symptoms that you know that somebody's had a near-death experience, is something called a panoramic life review. Now, the panoramic life review is a circumstance where you find yourself at the point of death reliving your life again, reliving snapshots of your life, either living the whole life again super fast, you know, people turn around when they're drowning and say, my life flashed before my eyes. And I thought, well, if you're in those kind of circumstances and you're in the final seconds of your life and you're living your life again, or reliving your life in this kind of flash of your life, you would regularly, in those circumstances, get flashes of recognition of circumstances you find yourself in because you've lived it before. And it was from that that effectively the first book is The Life After Death, The Extraordinary Science of What Happens When You Die, was written. But from your point of view, the more intriguing aspect of this was that the whole writing of the book delved me very, very quickly into Gnosticism. Because one of the fascinating aspects of this is that if we are living in a brain-generated illusion, which we believe to be our life, in other words, a reliving of our life again, that effectively is very much in keeping with the Gnostic tradition of the idea of the black iron prison, the mind forged manacles, the creation of the demiurge, or Yaldabaoth. The idea that we are living in an illusion that is created for us, and there is a reality behind the reality, the pleroma, the place behind.
Right.
But on top of that, we can also spin onto that into the concept of the Gnostic concept of the daemon and the eidolon. Because if I am living my life again. There is a part of me that has remembered the fact I've lived the life again. And of course, that to me is the daemon, the guiding spirit, the life force that guides ourselves through our lives. So that then stimulated my second book, The Daemon, A Guide to Your Extraordinary Secret Self. So I hope that's a little bit of a snapshot of the first two books. We can discuss my later books in due course, but effectively that's the snapshot of what started me writing and why I wrote what I did and why I wrote it.
I see. Yeah, what you described, I actually had a few experiences that were like that. I basically would have dream. I had this sense that I had a premonition of a dream, even though I wouldn't remember it. But I just had this sense that I experienced at this moment in time before. So I'm not sure what. I mean, could that be deja vu by chance?
Well, yes, I think it is, because deja vu. It's an interesting phenomenon in the sense that what academic work has been done on it. If you read a lot of the narratives for it in academic magazines or academic papers, they will invariably talk about something called the visual pathways hypothesis, which was something put forward by a guy called Robert Efron in 1961. And Efron suggested that what was happening when you had a deja vu sensation, or technically a deja vu sensation, an already lived sensation, is that the visual field, as you may or may not be aware, but the visual fields of each eye feed, in other words, the left visual field of your right eye and the right visual field of your left eye feed your left hemisphere, and vice versa. So both hemispheres of the brain have stereo vision. Okay? Now, what effectively this means is that on occasions, the visual information can be processed by the non-dominant hemisphere of the brain, ordinarily the right hemisphere. And what then happens is the image is sent across the corpus callosum, which is the body, the nerve body that holds the two sides of the brain together, and then feeds into the dominant hemisphere. Now, if that happens, there's a kind of an echo effect where the things you are seeing, you receive twice. You receive it from the non-dominant hemisphere, and then you receive it from your own dominant hemisphere. So there's a kind of an echo. And the delay there is about 0.5 of a second. So effectively, if the Efron thesis is correct, what it is suggesting is that on some occasions we have a delay of how we process reality by about 0.5 of a second. Mm-hmm. And this means that sometimes we will get the sensation of recognition of something we're seeing, because we have effectively already seen it. It's been processed by the brain a split second before. However, the overall issue I have with that hypothesis is that a deja vu sensation or a deja vu sensation is an overall sensation. It's not just visual. It's to do with hearing. It's tactile, and it also has this kind of very, very peculiar sense of dislocation. It's quite weird how you feel when you have these. But also recent work done by Dr. Akira O'Connor at the University of Leeds over here in the UK has shown that people who are born blind have deja sensations of hearing. In other words, they hear something twice. So they hear something and they'll hear it again. Now, the neurological pathways for hearing are quite different to the neurological pathways for sight. So if people have hearing deja sensations, the Efron thesis cannot explain it. So we're back to square one, in effect. Mm-hmm. So to me, deja vu or deja vu or deja senti or all the other variations on the deja phenomenon are, in fact, the fact that we are in some way either perceiving the future in the short term or we are living our lives again in a kind of a Groundhog Day scenario.
You know, it kind of reminds me of the movie The Matrix, by chance. I mean, I'm sure you watched it, but, you know, there's a scene where Neo and his friends go into a mansion, and then there's a cat that walks by, and then and then it changes again. And then he sees a cat again. So Trinity tells Neo that there must be a change in The Matrix. So I wonder if that has anything to do with it.
Totally, it very much does. That whole sequence I mentioned in one of my books, because it is again the idea that we are, because my latest work is very much reflecting on the idea that we are existing in a three-dimensional computer program, or an equivalent of a computer program. And my next book, The Infinite Mind Field, will be doing the science of this, of how it is possible that the information that is creating the reality around us is uploaded from something called the zero-point field. But we can probably touch upon that later. But effectively, the whole deja vu phenomenon as well is incredibly common. Some in the region of 70% of people have or will experience at some time in their life at least one deja vu sensation that will be a profound psychological impact to them. And in fact, I used to do a regular radio program over here on the BBC, BBC Radio Merseyside, and I was doing a program on deja vu, and a gentleman phoned up live on radio and said, "What you're talking about here will explain something that had happened to him." And he said he was watching television with his wife, and suddenly he felt very, very strange. He had that dissociation feeling that people have with deja vu. And then he could hear, and he was watching the television, and he could hear before the person had spoken on the television, he knew what they were going to say, he heard what they were going to say, and then they'd say it. He became so concerned about this that he excused himself from his wife, walked upstairs. As he did so, he saw people. He had a glass front door, and he saw people walk past the front door and walk past the front door again. So he was in some kind of weird time slip. He went upstairs, and he realized that he could probably prove to his wife that he'd become short-term precognitive. Because as he was walking downstairs, he knew what his wife was going to say as he went back into the living room. So he wrote it on a piece of paper, folded the piece of paper over, walked into the living room. His wife said what he knew she was going to say, and he handed her the piece of paper. And he had written on the piece of paper what he knew she was going to say. Now, that to me suggests that deja vu could also be far more complex than ever we believe. It's part of maybe the idea that we either are living our lives again, or we have an ability whereby we can monitor the immediate future of our environment. You know, a short-term precognition all the time that we're always slightly behind time. Now, there's been a lot of work done on this in recent years, and there is considerable evidence that we do actually process information at least 0.5 of a second before we realize the fact. So in other words, we are permanently half a second behind reality. And could this be, this is why we jump before we hear a bang. I don't know if you do, but I do it all the time. I'll go, ooh, and then there'll be a bang I'll hear somewhere. And there's a split second delay. It's as if my body has reacted far quicker to the hearing of the sound than I have consciously. Now this, again, there's another phenomenon which is very intriguing. I think it's around about 60 yards away. If you're in a car park or somewhere and somebody slams a car door, if it is within 60 yards, you will mentally be able to perceive that simultaneously. In other words, you'll see the car door slam and you will hear the sound at the same time, which is effectively impossible because light waves travel considerably faster than sound waves. So there should be a delay even if it's only 10 yards away, but there isn't. It's presented to consciousness simultaneously. It's as if the brain buffers the information of the light and the visual information until it's received the information with the sound, and then it puts the two together and presents it to consciousness. However, when it's more than a certain distance away, the brain cannot keep them separate, and suddenly you do get the delay sensation. Now, again, this has been put down to the fact that they believe the brain buffers information. And it buffers information so that we don't have the confusion of things being given to consciousness in a delay. For instance, you know, even the sensation of if you stub your toe, the pain you feel in your toe or the signal will take time to get to your brain, because effectively the speed that electronic signals travels through the nerves, particularly if they're myelinated, is quite slow. So again, we have this feeling of simultaneity. And there have been a series of experiments to prove this. We haven't got time to discuss them, but there's von Kohler's and von Grünau. There is also the Dean Radin Biermann experiments that show that we seem to be able to monitor the immediate future. They did this with the conductivity of the skin. What they did was they showed people a series of photographs of fluffy kittens and snow scenes and everything else. And interdispersed in these were photographs that were horrible, you know, mangled bodies, car crashes and things. And what they did was they actually placed sensors on the skin of the subjects. And apparently the electrical structure of the skin will change depending upon if we are frightened or we're disturbed. And they found that the skin reacted, the body reacted a split second before a horrible photograph was taken, which proved that the body knows in advance what's going to happen to it. And again, this could be because there's delay or various other reasons. Or it could simply be that in some ways we can be, under certain circumstances, precognitive.
So in essence, the body, I mean, it foresees an event that's going to happen to ourselves. Is that right? there's kind of like maybe a half a second difference in between the event that's going to happen and then it occurring, or is that?
Can you hear me? I lost.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can now.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So what you're saying is basically our body or our minds that we basically we foresee an event occurring and then we experience it. Like, there's like a half a second delay in between that event. Is that what you're saying, basically?
Yes. Yeah. In effect, well, it's one of two things. Either there's the half a second delay, or our overall concept of how the brain processes time is completely wrong. For instance, there's something called the Zeitrapper phenomenon. Where people have certain, when there are certain problems within the brain, suddenly for them, time starts to speed up. And on my blog site, I have a posting of one particular case of a guy in Germany who was driving along the Autobahn, and suddenly everything sped up for him to such an extent he had to stop the car because he was so terrified. And he in fact died around about 6 or 7 weeks later because he had some form of tumor on his brain, which was bringing about this perception of time speeding up. And we all know we have the phenomenon of time speeding slowing down. You know, when we're in a car crash, we're in an accident, when we're given bad news, time seems to just slow down. And again, I discuss this in my book, The Labyrinth of Time, as to what is taking place here. You know, and time is a subjective thing.
Right.
Now, if time is subjective and relative to each of us, this effectively means that we all exist within our own time zone, as it were, depending upon our mood and depending on our emotions. I can't remember the name of the guy now, but there was a guy in the 1960s that did a great deal of research on time perception. Was it Milton Erickson? I don't think it was Erickson, actually. But what they showed there was that fever. When the metabolic rate of the body is higher, our perception of time speeds up, slows down.
Okay.
And if this is the case, then this is again evidence that at the point of death, something very strange happens in the brain, in the sense we fall out of time. You know, effectively, these chemicals in the brain bring about the sensation that time slows down to such an extent that in the final seconds of your life, you can actually relive your whole life again in a three-dimensional matrix-like recreation of your life. Mm-hmm. While to the people viewing you, you die, but you never get there. It's almost a play around of Zeno's paradox, you know, Zeno's bisection paradox, you know, the idea that you'll never get to the end because you're living in smaller and smaller bits of time.
I keep thinking of that movie, This Is Your Life. I forget the name. I think that Meryl Streep was in it, but it came out maybe like a couple, like maybe maybe 20 years ago, maybe. But I remember it's all about in the afterlife, the soul experiences past events that occurs in their life, and they basically review it. So like a life review. So I think that movie, I don't know if you've ever seen it before, but
no.
But it came out quite a while ago. But Meryl Streep was in it. I just forgot the other name of the actor, but it's a really good movie. But it touches a lot of what you're saying. Now, in regards to Gnosticism, a lot of what you say, like with the Eidolon and the Daimon, you have this idea in Gnosticism that, of course, you have the ideal realm, which is very Platonic. And of course, corresponds to Pleroma. But we're basically like shadowy imitations or copies of these ideal types. So we're basically kind of a lower reflection of the higher aeons. In Gnosticism, they say there's a lower aeon and then there's a higher aeon. So I think those ideas pretty much correspond to what you're saying with the Eidolon and the Daimon. So which kind of gets me with my question, like how does your research get into Gnosticism specifically? Like are there other ideas besides the Eidolon and Dyad that corresponds to the Gnostic religion?
I think there is so much in the Gnostic belief system, whether I would call it a religion or a philosophy or a worldview, but I was surprised just how many Gnostic thinkers throughout the centuries have very much come up with similar models. I'm very much, for instance, the ideas of the Cathari in the south of France in the 13th century, and the things they believed in terms of the Parfait and the leadership of their religion and how their religion was structured implies that they were aware of the facts that we have this duality, that reality is an illusion, and a reality is created by the mind, and in which case we are in effect trapped within matter. And of course, it's somebody that we want to touch on later is Mani or Mani, and the idea that we have within ourselves a shard of the Pleroma, the shard of the fullness that we are denied because we are trapped within this physical universe. Now, this to me, like all religious beliefs, you know, going back to my own studies in religion when I was at university, religious beliefs are myths. And people tend to assume that the word myth suggests that it's untrue. And of course, what a myth is a way of explaining complex ideas in a way that people will understand. And if you look at the mythological aspects of Gnosticism, you will suddenly find that it's dealing with far deeper truths that modern science, modern quantum physics, modern neurology, modern consciousness studies are telling us about the way in which the brain actually works and the way reality works. You know, and the idea that consciousness creates the physical, in raised commas, world around us. You know, effectively, the idea that a subatomic particle, until it is measured or looked at or viewed, is a wave of probability. In other words, it has no tangible three-dimensional existence. It is just a wave of probabilities that the particle may be in one place rather than another. Mm-hmm. And when it is observed or measured, it collapses from being a potentiality and a statistical wave into being an actual physical particle. And of course, if we believe, which we should do, that subatomic particles are the building blocks of the physical Newtonian universe that we live within, effectively everything we perceive around us is therefore exactly the same. It has this superposition of being a wave or a particle. Now, there's been work done in recent years by a guy called Anton Zeilinger at the University of Vienna. And Zeilinger has actually shown that not only are subatomic particles like electrons or photons or whatever have this duality, but they've also found that atoms do. Not only atoms, but molecules, large molecules. I mean, the largest molecule they found that actually has this kind of strange wave-particle duality is something called a buckyball. Now, a buckyball is a large molecule made up of 60 atoms. Now, this is huge. This is a massive atom. And yet they found that if you do experiments on buckyballs and you duplicate something called the twin slit experiment, the buckyball will be a particle if it is observed, and it will be a wave and show wave-like elements to it if it is unobserved. Now, this has massive implications. Massive, massive implications. In fact, the implications are so great about this that a lot of this is not in the general knowledge area. It's not broadcast by the mass media, because the mass media really haven't got their head round exactly what the implications of this are, because the implications are clear. The reality is a construct of the mind. So the basic reality module is consciousness. But I'd take that one step back, and I'd say that we get confused because we fall into the idea of dualism and saying that mind and matter are two different things. And I think there's a better argument to say that mind and matter are just emanations of a deeper reality in which mind and matter are the same thing. It's totally non-dual, which, of course, is slightly a contradiction in terms of Gnosticism, which is a very dualistic religion, isn't it? You know, you take it back, the idea of the demiurge and the creation of the material universe.
Yeah, I mean, like in Gnosticism, you have the three natures. You have the spiritual, the psychic, and the hylic, or the material realm. But what you're saying, I mean, it definitely corresponds to science. I mean, I think Gnosticism is kind of like maybe the second major religious movement to actually correspond with quantum physics, because it basically says that we live in a deficiency of the material realm, and when you compare that to other religious systems, like in Hinduism, they talk about the Maya, Shakti, and how the world is basically kind of this playful illusion that we live in, or they call it Leela. When you look at compared to quantum physics, they say that the atom is very, it's like if you throw, if you compare an atom to an empty church, if you throw like a penny inside a giant church, that's, you basically compare that to the nature of an atom, because it's very empty in itself. So in essence, we kind of live in this very, invasive dream world, which kind of goes into my next question. Like, so if we live in a dream world, then when we dream, is that another deeper layer inside the dream? It's very strange with my question. Like, it's like a dream within the dream within the dream.
It's intriguing, this, that because again, I'm very fascinated by lucid dreaming. I'm fascinated by the out-of-body experience. I'm fascinated by remote viewing, and exactly what all these phenomena are telling us about consciousness and its relationship with the material world, the phenomenal world. And in my book, The Out-of-Body Experience, I review in great detail this idea of exactly what we mean when we're dreaming. And one of the things that one of my contacts recently showed me a fascinating simulation he'd set up in Second Life, whereby what he did was, he has, in Second Life, he has an office. He has offices in Second Life. And in fact, he interfaces with his work associates on Second Life in a virtual office. He's the CEO of a large organization. And this is what they do. And while we were on Second Life, he took me to one of these offices, and in one of the offices, one of his avatars was looking at a computer screen. So you're looking at your computer screen, and on the computer screen is an avatar looking at a computer screen. And on the computer screen that the avatar was looking at was another version of Second Life that was being run within Second Life. Right. And then if you looked, and this is going to get weirder, then if you looked at the screen on the screen in Second Life, there was another version of Second Life running on the screen in the screen. And he'd actually brought this back, almost back to, you know, you hold a mirror against a mirror. And as he was showing me this, he said, now imagine that there's somebody looking over your shoulder at you, looking at the computer screen, looking at the computer screen, looking at the computer screen. So he said, how far back in the kind of the idea of the Russian doll scenario of reality does real reality go back? Because we've got no way of knowing whether this is a completely powerful dream that we're living within. And I'm reminded of the Linklater movie Waking Life, if you've seen it.
I haven't seen it, but I've seen little clips, but I've yet to watch it, but I know what you're talking about, though.
Yeah, because it's well worth watching, because in that movie, the central character was somebody... I can't think of the guy's name now, the actor that takes the role off. But it's rotoscoped, so it looks like a cartoon. But in it, the central character doesn't know if he's awake or dreaming. Hmm. And he interfaces in this dream sequence with various talking heads, individuals who have researched the subject of lucid dreaming and various other things. And it shows just how difficult it is to really know whether you're dreaming or not. You know, one of the arguments people turn around to me and say that we know that this reality we exist within is real because it's consensual. In other words, you can agree with another person that the sky is blue, but you can't really, because we don't objectively know whether that person's concept of blue is exactly the same as my concept of blue. It's the concept of qualia. But suffice to say, as well, we know this world is a dream, because when I go to bed at night and I go to sleep and I dream, when I wake up the next morning, everything I left in my room is in exactly the same position, unless people have moved it around. But generally, the world is consistent. However, if your whole life is a dream, it will be consistent, because you go to sleep, you are awake in the dream, you go to sleep in the dream, and you wake up in the dream again. So effectively, the consistency argument is not necessarily valid. Now, I know of people that have what we call life dreams, where they have a dream and it's a whole lifetime. And they wake up, and I've had one or two of these, you know, where I feel I've been somebody else for years and years and years. And I wake up and I have this profound feeling of loss, that is if a whole life where I've had a wife and children and I've lived a life and I've just lost it and woken up into this reality. Now, who's to say that at the point of death you don't wake up again into an alternate reality again? As Lao Tzu said, the great Chinese philosopher, you know, am I a man dreaming I'm a butterfly, or a butterfly dreaming I'm a man? Because all we really know with any certitude is that we are sentient beings processing information. So there is something in your head or something located somewhere where your sensory apparatus feeds to that is doing perceiving. Mm-hmm. But that is all you know. You know, it's cogito ergo sum. It's the idea that all I really know is that I'm a sentience perceiving something. So reality could be an illusion. I'm part of your illusion in the same way that you are part of mine. Mm-hmm. Now, we could take this back to a much deeper level and suggest, as philosophers have suggested throughout the centuries, and modern writers such as Martin W. Ball and Professor Bernard Heischer writing about, that in fact consciousness itself is an illusion, and that we are all effectively one consciousness experiencing itself subjectively. Right. It's the old Bill Hicks monologue, isn't it? You know, that we are consciousness experiencing itself subjectively. Now, I've recently finished writing a biography of the American science fiction writer Philip K. Dick. And this is, again, one of the ideas that Philip K. Dick had. You know, the idea that we are all God. You know, we are God, for want of a better term, that has been embodied into the Gnostic world of Maya in order to experience itself subjectively, in order to just experience life. Right. You know, so in fact, you and I are both emanations of the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Now, is it like, do you believe in maybe animism? Do you think maybe plants and animals also have this divine spark like the Manichaeans did?
I think it's more complex than that. I think that's the concept really of panpsychism, you know, Spinoza and various other philosophers. I think it's more than that. I think that everything that is an emanation of it, whatever it is. The Kabbalists would call it our Ein Sof, the Ein Sof, the actual grounding, the grounding of everything.
Ground.
The ground, the actual ground, and the Godhead, you know, rather than the God. And the idea that, therefore, there is no individuation of anything. Everything is just a singularity. And the mind creates the illusion of space in order to exist within, and then it places that space in an illusion we know as time in order for things to happen. But in reality, even using the term reality becomes very, very, very difficult, because when you deal with these concepts, the words are so inadequate. So the idea is everything is alive in the sense that it is all an emanation of the same thing. The question is, where does that emanation exist? And where does the information that creates everything that is come from? And where is the singularity? And I think the singularity probably is the zero point field. And again, I've already been asked by one of my publishers to write another book on junk DNA, and the latest work that's been done on how DNA is structured and the way in which DNA actually gives off electromagnetic energy and various other things. And I find that I almost feel sometimes like everything is so complex and so simple at the same time. Mm-hmm. But even if it's so simple, it still doesn't explain why, if that makes sense.
It's kind of a paradox. everything's kind of a paradox, really, if you really think about it. And it's very maddening. So, I mean, that's what basically been plaguing philosophers for centuries, you know? What you just described to me, I mean, kind of reminds me of the Matrix again. I keep citing the Matrix for some reason. They talk about these different levels of reality in the Matrix. I mean, you have these different epochs. I guess I think they talk about maybe six versions of the Matrix. So it's kind of like, it's a kind of corresponds to that idea. And we get to like Nietzsche, he talks about the eternal recurrence, and you also have the Übermensch, which it kind of corresponds to Daimon a little bit, because he talks about how he uses the figure Zarathustra to represent the Übermensch, and yeah, how we're like these strong ideal man. But I think there's a deeper symbol for that, for the Übermensch. I think it's his own version of the Gnostic savior, or the Daimon. I think there's a correspondence between that. I don't know. I mean, it could be argued that way, but.
Oh, no, very much so. I totally agree with that. I think Nietzsche very much was a fascinating guy, in the sense that his concept of the eternal recurrence and the eternal return, which I think he first cites in The Gay Science, doesn't he, where he has the idea of Zarathustra, I think, having a discussion with a gnome or something. I can't remember exactly what the circumstances were. But he turns round and he says, imagine a demon whispering in your ear and saying that you will live this life over and over again in exactly the same way, with no change and no circumstances, and it will always be the same. Mm-hmm. And he turns around and he says that would be probably the most depressing thing you can ever imagine hearing. But then he reflects upon it and says, but actually it's the most liberating thing as well. Because if you live your life knowing that everything you do in your life will be repeated again and again and again, it makes you actually far more definite to make sure that what you do is right. So in which case you will make sure that you think rightly and you do the right things, because you're going to relive them again and again and again. Now, many people, when I first wrote my first book, a lot of people got confused because they thought I was rewriting, in effect, a Nietzschean idea of the eternal recurrence, of the eternal return, where you live the same life over and over again. But I'm not really saying that. What I say in the book, if people read it carefully, is I'm more applying the ideas of Peter Ouspensky, the Russian philosopher. And Ouspensky was very much saying that there is an eternal recurrence and an eternal return, but it's more like a spiral, in the sense that you live your life again, but you can change it. And by changing it, you change the overall tenor of your life and where you go. And I use the analogy here of the movie Groundhog Day. Mm-hmm. Because in Groundhog Day, you have the scenario of Connors, and he goes along to, he sees Groundhog Day, and he then gets caught in some kind of time warp where he lives the same day over and over again. Now, Danny Rubin, who is the author of the movie, is a great admirer of my work. In fact, I was delighted when he contacted me to say that he'd given copies of my book to all his friends, saying this guy has actually written the science of Groundhog Day. And indeed, I interviewed him recently in one of my own radio stations. And Danny tells me that in his original plan, he had Connors living that day thousands and thousands and thousands of times. And each day he subtly changes it, and each day he becomes a better human being. So here we have the concept of within the structures of your own life, you can evolve. So instead of being reincarnated as different people, and I've always had a problem with reincarnation because of that. If I'm reincarnated as somebody else with no memories of my previous life and memories of the errors I made in my previous life, how can I ever improve? You can only improve by recognizing the fact that you've made an error and putting it right. Mm-hmm. So you live your same life again, and this time your daemon, who remembers the fact you've lived your life before, can give you little subtle clues, little movements, become the literal guardian spirit to make sure that you don't make those errors this time round, and you take a different route. Now, if we use the analogy of modern video gaming and first-person RPG games, it starts to suddenly make sense, because if I am a game player playing a game, say, because I'm showing my age here, I'm playing Tomb Raider, and Lara Croft is on the screen, and she runs down a corridor, and in the first start of the game, she gets attacked by a huge monster, and she gets killed. As far as the Eidolon, which is the Lara Croft sprite on the screen, she has died. Mm-hmm. However, I am the daemon, because I am watching her, and I've realized what she's done. So next time when I resurrect Lara after her death to come back again and run down the corridor, this time round, from the viewpoint of Lara, something suddenly makes her change direction and go down a different path. She feels that she's being motivated to do that by her own actions. But the reality is the game player who's watching her on the screen is the person that's made her avoid the monster. She goes further down and she gets eaten or killed again. So she goes back and she lives her life again. And this is exactly how computer games work, isn't it? You know, you eventually get through the maze and you survive. Now, if this is the case, this is what I'm suggesting, is that the daemon is the game player of your life. And you have as many run-throughs of your life as you possibly can. You are playing the game of your life. And what you do is you play it time and time again until you get it right, until you become an avatar or a bodhisattva, until it's right to you. Now, when you then get it right, you complete the game and you're allowed to die. And then you move on. It's again, we can apply this to the Bardo state, or the Bardo Thodol, and the idea again, you know, the Book of the Dead, where they say that we go into this nether region which is between life and death, and we exist within that place. It's the old Catholic idea of purgatory. It's the concept that Philip K. Dick put forward in his book Ubik, which he called Half-Life. It's again a very, very powerfully explanator of the human condition. And I think a lot of people who've read my books have really missed the point of where I go with it. It's far more powerful as an explanator than most people believe. And in doing so, it brings in Gnosticism, it brings in Taoism, it brings in Hinduism, it brings in Buddhism, Zoroastrianism, right. The Manichaeans. It is all in there, all the elements of it, in a kind of an amalgam religion. Mm. Well, religion is the wrong term. Philosophy, as you will.
Right. The Gospel of Philip talks about the intermediate state quite a bit, actually. I mean, I think it's another text on the origin of the world that uses the Sophia character as a veil between the material realm and the divine realm. So I think that has a lot to do with it. I have so many ideas swarming in my head. There's another.
Always do when people encounter my work. They always do. You know,
there's a movie that I saw a while back. It's called The Nines. I don't know if you ever heard of it.
No.
Ryan Reynolds is in it. I don't know if you know the actor by chance.
No.
Okay, well, it's a really good movie, and it describes to a T what you're talking about with a lot of video game references, and it uses very Matrix-like ideas. It's very Gnostic. I highly recommend to anybody. But yeah, I think you should, if you go to the video store or go to Netflix, I'm sure it's on Netflix if you have an account there, but it's really, really good. Wow. Also, another idea kind of comes to mind is the idea of predestination fate. Like, I mean, is everything that we... I mean, it's basically... What you're describing is basically a kind of a fatalistic idea, right? I mean, or am I wrong?
Right. Is it predestined? Well, it's an interesting point. If every single outcome of every single decision you make in your life is already predestined, yes, it is. But... it's only predestined in the sense that every alternative is predestined. Mm-hmm. Now, again, going back into modern particle physics, Stephen Hawking and an associate of his, Thomas Hertog, postulated in 2006 a new interpretation of particle physics, which they call the top-down interpretation. And in this is Stephen Hawking, by the way, you know, this is not the guy down the pub, this is you know, one of the world's leading physicists. And he says that what is actually taking place is that every possible outcome of every decision is already encoded somewhere. He never actually says where the encoding takes place. And I think, again, it's the zero-point field. And our acts of observation continually, as we move around observing our reality, we collapse the wave function, or we collapse the wave function of that future rather than the alternate future. And we are doing this all the time. We are continually collapsing wave functions by the act of observation. So therefore, we're making our way through the path of the computer program by our act of observation, with help through our daemon. So this means, yes, there is predestination. But predestination, if we go back to the Calvinistic idea of predestination, right, which to me, when I was younger, was a profoundly beguiling logic, that if God knows, if God is omnipotent and omniscient and outside of time, he therefore must know everything that is ever going to happen. Therefore, he must know everything that is going to happen to you, and therefore you must be predestined to go to heaven or hell because God knows that you're going to go to heaven or hell. And whatever you do, you cannot change that. But that's in a singular universe. Mm-hmm. And a singular universe where there's only one path and one path of time. However, if there are a myriad of paths and times you can follow, you're not predestined. You know, no more than Lara Croft on your computer screen is predestined. Mm-hmm. But of course, the logic is, in many ways, when we think about Lara Croft on the screen, going back to the computer analogy, where is Lara Croft? You're looking at a screen. The screen is registering digital information that is on a disk, which has been programmed by a computer programmer years ago. The images of the screen are processed by your eyes, the photons coming off the screen, and of course the electrons on the screen. The electrons at the back of the screen then are turned into photons, which then go into your eye, which then get converted into electrical signals and nerve signals, which go into the visual cortex of your brain, which are then processed within the visual cortex of your brain and become images, which are perceived by somebody supposedly inside your head, the little homunculus that's in your head. But there's nowhere in that scenario where Lara Croft is or where the passageway that she's going down is, because it's as much an illusion as everything else. So when we think really deeply about the true nature of the interface between perception and reality, in other words, when we take it one step back, we take it back from the materialist reductionists and take it right back to exactly what we know about anything, you know, the ontological questions of what it is to be, we then find ourselves in this very, very peculiar scenario where my hypothesis is just as rational as anybody else's is.
Yeah, in Gnosticism, they do have an idea of predestination, but it's not like like John Calvin would say, like if you're gonna either you're gonna go to heaven or you're gonna go to hell. It basically says that you are there's basically three natures. There's the, like I said before, the spiritual, the psychic, and the material. but they all go to their separate destinations. The spiritual essence goes to the Pleroma. Meanwhile, the psychic part is either damned to nothingness, basically, because the material is basically an illusion anyway. So it doesn't really, it's not really damned to hell. It's just the material part basically kind of dissolves on its own, as the spiritual essence kind of leaves the material realm. So without the spirit, the material realm is basically, you know, dark, nothing. It's kind of like a void. Man, I have like so many ideas that I want to talk about right now. Oh, another question is, how would you describe your cheating the ferryman hypothesis? How does that? I mean, like, I'm still a little bit unclear on that and how it relates to everything else.
Well, the cheating the ferryman hypothesis is basically what I've described in general terms. So let's go back to the point of death. Okay, there you are. You're about to die. As you start to die, what tends to happen is there's a release of neurochemicals in the brain. Effectively, in my initial book, I very much discuss and focus in on glutamate, which is the major neurotransmitter of the mammalian brain. And at the point of death, it is known that glutamate floods the brain. And in doing so, the brain tries to protect itself, because the major problem with a lot of glutamate, it's excitotoxic. It actually kills brain cells. So the brain cells protect themselves by fighting the glutamate. In doing so, what basically happens is the brain starts to slow down its own perceptions. And it starts to slow down its perceptions of time. Now, one of the major descriptions of near-death experience is that time starts to slow down for people. It's, again, one of the moody traits, and it's one of the Grayson, on the Grayson scale as well. Bruce Grayson is another researcher in the subject matter of near-death experiences. Mm-hmm. And time starts to slow down, and then your past life memories are drawn up from the zero-point field. And you are literally catapulted back to the time of your birth. Okay? Now, one of the things that people say many times is that when this happens, they have this life flashing before their eyes. And I argue that happens in a near-death experience, in the sense that you don't die. The very fact that you've come back to the world we live in to tell other people you've had the experience proves to me that you haven't actually died. What has happened is you've got very close to death, and the daemon has realized that you're not about to die this time, and it metaphorically presses a fast forward of your life. The recording of your life is fast forwarded, so you report back that you saw your life flash before your eyes. In an RDE, a real death experience, life doesn't flash by. Okay, so what you do is you live your life again in this kind of computer program, and you make all these different decisions. But at the end of that second life, you approach death again. Now, again, you fall out of time, and again, you have a past life review. So you live another Groundhog Day, another Groundhog life. But if we take Zeno's bisection paradox to its logical extreme, each of these lives take place in a smaller bit of time. So you know the old idea of the frog, of frogs in the middle of a pond, and it can hop from plant to plant to get to the end of the pond, but each hop is half the size of the hop before. So the first hop, it gets halfway across the distance to the end of the pond. The next hop, it gets a quarter of the way. The next one, it gets an eighth, then a 16th, then a 32nd, and a 64th. You quickly realize that the frog never gets to the end of the pond, because every time it's bisecting into smaller distances. So it never gets there. This is what happens to us at death, and this is what cheating the ferryman means. Because in the ancient Greek myths, you may recall that when somebody died, what they used to do was place a little coin called an obolus over underneath the tongue of the corpse. This was so that when the corpse found itself at the banks of the River Styx, it could pay the ferryman, Charon, to take them over to the land of the dead, to the underworld. Okay? But because they don't pay the ferryman, they cheat the ferryman out of his fee to take them over to the land of the dead because they never get there. But there's an interesting aside to this that I think, again, myths can tell us greater truths. Because in the ancient Greek myths, when you went over to the land of the undead, or the dead, when you went over to the river Styx, you crossed the Styx, but there was another river there called the Acheron. And the Acheron was known as the River of Forgetting. Because when you crossed the Acheron, there was another river, the Acheron, and when you were at the land of the dead, you were given the opportunity of staying there or going back and living your life again, your own life. But in order to do that, you had to drink the waters of another river. That's right, it's the Acheron. There's another river then called the Lethe. And you had to drink the waters of the river Lethe to go back and live your life again. But what the river Lethe did was, it was the river of forgetting. So if you drank the waters of the Lethe, your memories of your previous life were washed clean. Then you crossed over the river Styx again, back to live your life again, with no memories of the fact you'd lived it before. And this is exactly, again, what Cheating the Ferryman proposes. That when we are back here now, living our life again as an Eidolon, the Eidolon does not remember the fact that it is living its life again. But its daemon does, because the daemon has never drank the waters of the Lethe. So the daemon knows about the life. But the Eidolon, the everyday self that lives in linear time, does not know. Now, again, referencing a lot of the work of Philip K. Dick, one of the themes of Philip K. Dick, and then one of the Gnostic aspects of the writings of Philip K. Dick, is the God who has forgotten who he is. I don't know if you're aware of this, but if you read his book, The Divine Invasion, there is a little boy in that book called Manny. Mm-hmm. And Manny is Jehovah. Manny is God who has forgotten he's God, and he's living the life as a child in this world. And he is the God trapped within this world. And within the Divine Invasion, you actually have Yaldabaoth. You actually have the symbolism of the adversary who knows that God is trapped in matter and wants to destroy him and kill him, which is, of course, incredibly Gnostic. And, of course, the other thing that's fascinating about the writings of Philip K. Dick is the female character in that movie, in that book, is the symbol of Sophia. Mm-hmm. You know, wisdom. And Sophia is the embodiment, the female embodiment of wisdom. But then you twitch this back and you go into the Kabbalistic viewpoint and you have the Shekinah, the female principle that's within the Gnostic aspects of the Kabbalah. And if the Kabbalah is profoundly Gnostic when you really get into it, as is Sufism.
Yeah.
You know, and you get into the Sufi ideas as well. So the ideas of Sophia being the releasing principle, that it's powerful stuff. And it again makes sense. And it again makes sense. So that is effectively what Cheating the Ferryman is, in simple terms. if Cheating the Ferryman can ever be simple.
Yeah. I mean, definitely makes sense to me. Which kind of, when you talked about Mani, kind of goes back into my last question of his interview. How does the daimon correspond with the light twin in Mani? Because you know, Mani, you know, he had this divine revelation that, you know, and he basically had this revelation that, you know, basically there's two ontological principles. There's, of course, the light and the darkness is a very, you know, even more dualistic than the Gnostics were. But I think that idea, I think, still corresponds to what you're saying. So what's your thoughts on that?
I was delighted. You're the first interviewer to ask me about Mani. When I first came across the life of Mani, I struggled to get hold of various books about him because he was intriguing. And he argued that when he was young, his divine twin, Al-Twam, or Tawam, had manifested in his life and had told him that he was his own higher being, his own higher self that had lived his life before. He knew where his life was going to go, and that he was the tool of enlightenment that would actually allow Mani to become the great religious leader he was to become. Mm-hmm. Now, to me, if you extrapolate the tale of Mani and then you place it in the lives of other saints throughout history, For instance, I'm reminded of Joan of Arc. And if you look at the story of Manny, and then you look at Joan of Arc and the manifestation of the voice that she hears, that guides her through her life, that gives her precognitive ability. She finds a sword in a church that nobody else could find because the voice told her. The voice tells her to do certain things in her life. And I don't know if you know, but when she was eventually captured, the voice told her that she should not try to escape. Mm-hmm. And she decides to not, for the first time in her life, to not follow what the voice told her. And she jumps out of a tower. And she breaks her leg. I think she broke her leg or something, or sprained her ankle or something. She was recaptured. And after that, the voice didn't manifest anymore because it was so hacked off with the fact that she hadn't followed its instructions. In other words, going back to the game player, there was the voice, which was Joan of Arc's game player, Joan being the sprite on the screen. It's the sprite on the screen suddenly didn't follow the instructions of the game player and ended up having herself killed. With Manny, it's the same idea. The game player manifests in Manny's life because it realizes that Manny has a manifest destiny that he has to follow. Of course, it didn't actually end up very nice because, as I recall, Manny was probably flayed alive in the end, and it ended up very nastily for him. But because the voice knew, the Altoir knew that he had to follow this course of action in this life, probably in the next life, Manny would have followed a different course of action. But the course of action that's come down to our history, through our history, was that. Now, on top of that, you are aware, I suppose, well, you will be aware being a Gnostic scholar, but the Song of the Pearl.
Right.
And in the Song of the Pearl, what do we have? We have, again, the analogy of two individuals. One individual that goes down, I think, to Egypt and lives one life, and he's guided by another life that lives somewhere else. So again, we have the dichotomy of two beings existing effectively in the same body. So again, we have again and again. I think again in Sufism they have something about going to the mountain of Qafs, I think, in one of the great Sufi legends. And again, that can be read as being a symbol of the daemon and the higher self. So Manny was intriguing. In fact, in the first version of my book, Is There Life After Death, there was a whole section on Manny, which unfortunately was taken out by the publishers and the editors because we didn't have enough space to continue with it. And indeed, one of the things that I find very frustrating is the lack of material on the life of Manny, because I think if we really found out more about him, we would find some very intriguing ideas that would again support my hypothesis, I would like to believe.
Yeah, he basically had a whole, almost like a universal religion that lasted for quite a number of years. So, I mean, I think there's a few Manichaeans. We actually spoke to a Manichaean in our past show a while back, and he kind of basically went to the same ideas you're talking about. But I think there's also like there's Manichaeans in China, especially, and I kind of think the Buddha, is kind of modeled after Manny, not the other way around. But I mean, I could be wrong.
I very much in my next book, The Infinite Mindfield, I trace a particular idea that started in ancient Sumer, and then worked its way across what we now know as the Silk Road, from Sumer eastwards to set up Taoism. To actually then go into the Tibetan Plateau to set up the Bon tradition and then move down and created Hinduism and Buddhism. And I think that if you look back, you will find that there's this universal truth. And interestingly enough, I think this universal truth can actually be tied back to two things. I think it could be tied back to the legend of Soma and Kaikeyan, and the idea of there are certain beverages that can actually allow access to your own higher self. And I think on top of this, I think there are legends about the pineal gland that can be very much tied into all this, because at the moment I'm working on an uber hypothesis about the nature of reality, the nature of consciousness, the nature of how these legends start. And what I'm finding is that it's becoming so syncretic in the information I'm taking and pulling together that it surprises the hell out of me. I have to say that my next book, I am absolutely staggered as to the information I've put in there. And I believe it's my own daemon, and this is where I think I'm daemon-led. Because time after time, when in my writings, information, I am led to information by instinct. You know, I have not got a game plan on this, and my writing has never been a game plan, eidolonically, but demonically, I think there is a game plan here. And suddenly, you know, I'm resonating with so many different people. I was talking to a PhD student 2 days ago in Birmingham in the UK when I did a lecture, and we were discussing there about some of the latest research being done in terms of consciousness and consciousness studies and everything else. And I'm right on the ball here with some leading edge work that's been done, you know, and how I've instinctively found myself in that position, I have not got a clue. But I seem to be talking truths that are coming out now as I research them, more and more is being discovered. For instance, there was some recent work done by a guy called István Bokken, Professor István Bokken in Hungary. And Bokken has actually shown that the eyes give off photons, the eyes give off electromagnetic energy. Now, this is intriguing stuff because this goes right back to my latest hypothesis about the nature of DNA. And I'm not going to ruin anything by talking about this, but I'm linking everything from DNA to Gnosticism to Taoism to Sufism. It all links in to a lot of the modern science that we're now discovering about the nature of reality.
Wow, I can't wait to read it. Are you writing it right now? Or
I finished it. It's out on September the 2nd.
Oh, wow.
It will be released in the UK and the USA on September the 7th. September the 2nd. It's already up for pre-order on Amazon UK and Amazon USA, and I think Amazon Canada. So it's already there. It's written. It's done. You know, it's put to bed. And this will blow people's minds, believe me. This book, if it gets the right coverage, is going to really, really shake a lot of trees.
Wow, I can't wait to read it. Going back to Mani, I have a bunch of PDFs on Mani, so I could maybe forward to you in later.
Please, email. Yeah, no, that would be wonderful. I am aware of time now because I'm going to have to be shooting off in about 2 or 3 minutes. So.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, I mean, it was great to have you on. I'd love to interview you again. With my co-host, which unfortunately he's not here, but I'd love to do that in the near future. But I think it's about time, all the time we have today with on Aeon Arcanum. So I thank you for joining us, Anthony.
Thank you very much.
All right. Take care. Bye.
Okay, see ya. Bye.